Bagwell brothers that lived on Moody Street. And I remember them even as a child, and how we'd squeal and carry on when they was playing basketball. And they brought a lot of trophies to Monaghan up there. In the main lobby of the Y was a chest that held all of those trophies. And it was our delight, even after we got older, to go and show people the accomplishments that Monaghan did have in our teams. Because there was a lot of a competition in all of that, competitive. So also, when the church burned, that was the place where the Monaghan Baptist Church met until the church was built down, is it Revenue?
Revenue
Street. And at the last service up there, Preacher Jolly was telling us now the next time we met, we would meet in the new church. I was 12 years old, and I was sitting there on the front row, and I had several girlfriends that really one I just grew up with for 14 years, Moselle Broom, that married Mr. Timoton, and Irene McIntyre, and then Evelyn Hawkins, and then we knew Gladys. They didn't live there long, they moved. But anyway, up on Parker Road, you know the apple don't fall far from the tree. There's Jack, Carol, and all of them. They moved right up there where we could walk to their houses. And Daddy didn't want to move up there. He had a chance to move, but he didn't. And so, I'm kind of glad, because I've learned to love 20 Speed Street, and I've always loved it. We bought the house. Daddy didn't want to buy it, and my husband and I bought it. And we've been there ever since and reared our children there. But I do know that that very night, the last night of the service, God spoke to my heart. And I went down and gave my heart to the Lord that very night.
Amen.
Just before we went into the new church. And later on, you know how growing up you can, maybe you have an experience, but not really a dedication. But one day on June the 8th, 1942, at Tremont Avenue Church of God, I really and truly gave my heart to the Lord. And it's been that ever since. I mean, I have grown in the Lord ever since. But let me tell you, there's something about this Monaghan Baptist Church that I have never, never lost my love for. It's never depleted. It's always been there. Because this is home. It was a foundation where Mother and Daddy taught us the Word, and through keeping us in church and in devotions. And there was just something about Monaghan Church that has always been a highlight in my life, and it still is today. And it's just a joy and a privilege to come up here and visit with them and have that fellowship, because I grew up with them, and I feel like it's my family. And so it was an honor when Don asked me if I would come and speak. I said, oh, yes, because I've got so many memories, and they're pleasant memories. Nothing to look back and regret on. I know the houses have been sold, and then them been sold, and a lot of it maybe has kind of run down a little bit, but all in all, it's still a classy place.
Were Jack and Gladys, did either of you work in the mill? Describe that a little bit, if you would.
My mama got me a job with Tom Hughes. I know lots of you remember him. In the drawing-in room, and I was as scared of him as a bear. And all those other ladies that worked in the drawing-in room, they just worked just as hard as they could, and I didn't want to work, so I just messed around. I was a pain for him, but he would... when I'd make a mistake, he would walk in front of me and carry me out to the weave room and show me my mistake. And then he would cut the warp out. And then, you know, see, that was money that I had lost, but it didn't bother me at all. Mm-hmm. Then during the war, Moselle Hudgens and Elsie Trainum and I, we worked up in the spooler room. See, lots of the men were gone in service, and we worked up there.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Years ago, I would work at Monaghan and go to Parker High School. They would let you work in the mill and to school. Mm-hmm. And I worked there. And then when in '44, when I finished, I went to work there at Monaghan, and they put me learning to lift out warps. I'd carry them up to Gladys and them, and they would redraw these warps and everything. I did that along with Charlie Waldrop. And then they wanted to put me down there weaving one day on some looms, and I went down there weaving, and I got a job then. I had an offer to go off singing in 1944, and so I went to Dallas, Texas, singing for the Stamps Music Company.
You know, you was talking about, did you work at Monaghan? Dad was seriously injured in service, and as he grew older, his back was giving him so much trouble, till us girls had to, we was in Parker, had to go to work. And so in order for me to still go to school, I had to work at night. And I worked in the weave room and filling the batteries of the looms. Mm-hmm. And what was so, they wouldn't believe it now, but for five nights a week, I would go to school and I would fill those batteries for $11.40. That was our straight salary. And out of that, I was able to go downstairs where the concession stand was and get a hot dog and a drink. That's what I got out of it. And the rest I had to go to Mother. Uh-huh. But, you know, we didn't mind that. It was something that most everybody was accustomed to, and we didn't think nothing about it. And but anyway, it was a good days. And by talking about those ice men, girls, I can remember that. We would ask for ice that maybe where they chipped it, some of the ice would fall down. He would give us that to suck on, and we was always looking for that. And then we had dirt roads. I can remember the roads being dirt and the road scrapers coming around, and I was always so tickled when those road scrapers come around, because when it rained, the children's shoes stayed so muddy and dirty. And it was a glad day when we saw not only our roads resurfaced, but not only bathrooms come into our house. And we was the first ones to get a phone on Speed Street, and it was always such a joy for people to come down there and use the phone, because we liked that company.
And, yeah, but there was three people on that line. Yeah. And everybody knows everybody.
That's right, that's the way that it was. But and you'd pick it up and somebody would be talking, they'd say, "Hang up, I'm talking." But it was always, you can look back and reflect back on it and say that it was a lot of fun. And I, as I said, I cannot look back and say, well, I regret a thing, because we had a full life there. And I really did truly appreciate our neighbors. We had neighbors back then. My, you knew everybody. And if you got in trouble or anything, they was right there to help you.
Yes, sir.
And so I can truly say today, here in 2007, I've still got those good neighbors. And I've got a lot of my neighbors that grew up like myself right there at Monaghan, and they've never moved. And so I can say that we've had some beautiful neighbors down through the span of life that I know at Monaghan.
Back years ago, you know, we had no electric refrigerators. And we'd have these ice cards.
Here it is, right
and
here.
You could put... we'd put ice, 25, 50 pound, and 100 pound. Yeah. And you'd turn that card up to what, how much
well,
you wanted,
you
and you would leave your house unlocked for mm-hmm. the ice man to come in and put it
That's
in.
Right.
And I remembered when my mother bought her first electric refrigerator from Haley. It was an old GE up on legs, and she paid 25 cents a month till she
That's
paid
right.
it off.
Talking about the ice, the ice box in the house, they had to make a hole in the floor.
That's right.
So that the water would drip down out of the
either
this hole.
Or a pan room.
And we had a playhouse under there, and that was our kitchen, and we got our water from there to play with the water under there.
Monaghan was the first to ever start a high school.
Mm-hmm.
We had a high school in our gym when it burnt down. They went over on 10th Street, and Dr. Hollis taught school on 10th Street over there till Mr. Parker and them could arrange to get property over there at the Bill Parker High School. Mm-hmm. Now, that's the first.
Right.
Now, Monaghan was the first to ever have a camp. And they had reason over. And my dad and his carpenters from all three plants would go up there in April, the last of April, and they'd start and remodeling the houses. And then each meal would have a week at a time to come to reason over. We never did go because my dad would go up there and my mother and all the carpenters' wives would go up there and they would cook for the men while they did the work, and they would build boats for the lake, and they would make paddles for them and everything, old wooden boats. And Monaghan was the first to ever have a camp, and that was sure. reason over. And I guess the you girl, and your family went
oh,
many
yeah, we
times.
Went. And we had the Boy Scouts.
Yeah.
Grady
oh,
Trainum
yeah, Boy Scouts. Yeah,
was
Charles
over was the Boy Scouts, and they would go and stay a week. And if you was lucky enough to get to go up there when the Boy Scouts was there, you had a better time.
he was talking about his dad, but the thing that I can remember about Mr. Pittman was his wonderful singing. He had the most beautiful voice, and he led singings. And so my, recollection of him was that he and Jack and all of them, Jack followed his footsteps. And we know that he organized the Palmetto Quartet, and what a joy it has been to listen to him. And we got tapes now that we still play and listen to his voice. So I'm going to brag on him whether yeah. he did or not.
Gladys brought up about them putting the bathrooms, or either you
yeah,
or...
Yeah, the bathrooms, yes.
Bathrooms on the back porches, and you had this great big old tank up at the
oh,
top
yeah.
up there, and so you would sit down on the stool.
Oh, yes.
And then boy. When you didn't get up fast enough, it'd wash your fanny off.
Well, that was good.
I think, just had to say that.
Right. We appreciate that. I think we can all agree here today that it wasn't easy growing up on the mill.
No.
It was
no.
sometimes right. hard. And we next want to talk about how, several of you have hit on this already, but maybe just a quick overview again of how Monaghan Mill Village has impacted your life. One lady talking about the early years on the Mill Village said it was a little bit of like heaven on earth. And that may be a little stretch. I don't know what heaven's exactly like, but she was trying to, I think, tell us that certainly the care for each other and the love and concern for fellow
That's right.
man was prevalent on the Mill Village. And but if you can just go through and just a quick synopsis of how Monaghan, or you feel like, has impacted your life in the early years, and how you've passed it on to your children. And
well, one thing that I can remember is that the people at Monaghan just didn't stay in that level. They rose on up and accomplished a lot of things
exactly.
in their life, and still it remained a good. And though they were moving in and out, as he said, if they didn't work at Monaghan, they had to move. But after they sold the houses, that was different, you see. But anyway, those that we grew up with have gone on and accomplished a lot in their life. I never knew growing up at Monaghan that one day I would stand before great crowds and minister of the word. But you see, God knows what we have, and if we just let him lead our lives, how that it grows on to be a blessing to
right.
others.
Amen.
And so that's the thing that I can see about Monaghan is they didn't just, as I said, just live there, but they went on and accomplished many things.
So we can attribute that to some of our leaders giving us that
yes,
desire to progress
it, yes.
and to move on. And
that's right.
And I think Dr. Hollis and even the Lewis's, Lewis Parker and Thomas Parker mm-hmm. had that aspiration to help the people
that's
to grow
right.
and provide the best community possible for its people. So,
and we had a wonderful pastor, Reverend Jolly. He lived down below us there, and Mary, Ben, and all of us, we all played together as little children, and I had the privilege to be married in the parsonage down there. John and I married there, and that's been 68 years ago.
Right, and certainly the teachers in the schools also attributed much to our progress and our desire to excel, really. So Jack,
the Monaghan people were so close to one another.
That's right.
If someone would get sick, like my neighbor got sick here, my mother would cook pies. She would cook for them until they got better. And they on either side of us, anybody got sick, I mean, we'd take my mother and dad would take care of them, although we didn't have no money. But they would get up something to eat for them.
But I can remember as a boy going through the mill village and taking up what they call poundings for people that was out of work.
That's right. We'd help each other.
And certainly that aspect was instilled into my life to where I want to do that today even, you know, to help people that are out of work. Or
talking about our parents' mother, Ms. McIntyre, that lived behind us there on Beta Street, was in a serious car wreck and lost one of her arms. My mother not only went over there every day and dressed that arm for her, but she would always carry them their meal because they had three children at that time, and so mother knew she couldn't cook. So I can see us now carrying this. I've still got that tray, a little silver tray, full of food over there and all for them to eat. Now, as he said, we watched after each other. Mm-hmm.
One writer describes the mill village as like a family, and I think we could all agree.
It is one big family.
Like one big family.
Well, I was just going to say that I had a good mother and daddy, and I was raised in a Christian home, and they was good people around us, but they all wasn't good. They was some mischievous ones, but just like there is today. But long time ago when someone passed away, they would bring the body back to the house. And you would sit up with them people all night long.
That's right, somebody would.
Would sit there with that person all night long and see that they had food and everything. But it was a good community, and there's a lot of good people there.
Amen. I'm the best.
Okay, I wanted to kind of wrap it up, if you could be thinking about this. One favorite memory that you might have growing up, something that sticks with you through the years. I'll just share a quick one of mine. And I wrote about it in our memories, a little book that we're putting together, was the first grade at Monaghan up on a stage at Christmas time. We all had to memorize Luke's account of the birth of our Savior. And my mind every year at Christmas goes back to that. That seemed like the whole world was out in the audience, but it was just a small crowd there in the school auditorium. But I always think about that every Christmas and how we were able to tell the story of Christ in schools, which today that's not politically correct, and we're not able to do that. But this kind of contrast in the times that we live in today versus 40, 50 years ago. But if